discover when they got back that seconds of the evening was included there first. So if you want food at lunchtime, you either buy it over the living, it'll take you longer than an hour, or eat here and then nip over and get a food if you like. I'll warn you the crossroads that there's an accident black spot. And when they run over, they go to the sergeant, they play back. Dance in front of But Martin, maybe not, I don't imagine Martin there, but I want him to reflect on some music. Now, firstly, right, we're groups. Now, we all come from a group of people who, on the whole, are a minimum of 7 people. I'm raised by one of those people in all kinds of 6 people. I'm just about twice that number.
I'm going to go off people.
Why? Try suit the people you want to attract, which means that some of you who are getting older perhaps should take a back seat or get involved in the one of the characters of the Morris. Sense of claim that they might have rather than the sense of sin. Right. So, one of the objectives of the book, you know, it's normally one of these you don't actually even address. I want to be a Morris officer. I want to be a Morris group. I went along to overnight, and it was great people I met. I want to enjoy it. I want to be in that social group and so on. Now, some of them protecting on the Morrisons. Having said that, I can think of many clubs that split because one half thought they didn't practice enough, and the other half thought they practiced too much. Other half thought they all took it too seriously. You know, you can enjoy yourself. And you find it. But today it's not so bad. When I say today, in 1997, there are enough sides on the grade that you can actually find one of the suitors. They're having to travel too far. It may be in the wilderness of Exeter or something like that. That's the problem. But deciding what it is you want to do, you know, or you as a club, is important. Thirdly, what I was involved was I, let's get away from the family group. One night a week, wives and daughters, you get away from everybody, meet somebody who might interest, sit in the corner and have it. Chat to the pseudo-mum, Marguerite, and so on. He did them a world of good. Didn't necessarily lead to good dancing. Right? There are others, in which I would propose to say the please one, where they actually get together to dance. You know, it's not a social club, really. I mean, that's a social aspect. But it actually, they get the, we have a shorter evening, and you don't sit there. Right? Not having chairs, not having a tea break, or not having drinks, is actually conducive to a good hard work day. If that's what you want it for. You know, but it's too easy to have a democratic meeting where you sit there, of which perhaps two-thirds of the people there haven't thought about the issue, and you're asking them to make an off-the-cuff response to what it is you want. Very rather ways of doing that. One is that as a Morris Club you need insurance. In this day and age you sue until you're all broke and not married. young person at all, expected to be able to join the others when they drink the pub, and when they were like 22, 23, they also expected to drop out and let somebody else take over. The young person. Now that's all very well in that environment, but the likes of the people here were actually in a long-term situation. They're actually not interested in what happened to us 20 years ago. So you know, we're just all right. Now, what has changed in the meantime, which is the last society is, if you work with these clubs, you're quite used to that youth club, covers sort of 12 to 15 year olds in general. You don't get the older ones, first of all, and the wouldn't want to reach the kids, but also they're all too busy coaching. They're all too busy getting themselves organised and life as well. But what has happened is that at the time you get 40, life is such now that they sort of leave their teenage children or near teenage children, look after themselves, take care of the baby. So you have a generation of people who are older, maybe 40, older than you go, but have less responsibility than the solo 40 years earlier. Certainly they are fitter, healthier, more money in their pocket and so on. jolly good playing along the song, and they had no trouble at all with any book to achieve, of course. But they had been successful in an area that were wealthful of, in their locality, and they were wealthful of Bible standards, so it was about the Jews and were down. There are those signs, of course, who pursued excellence. You really want to be as good as anybody. Also get intense satisfaction from doing it. The only problem comes when there's another side which in fact don't make up its mind which of the two it is. I can remember, I was in Crowley Way Western, invited to run a weekend workshop because the enthusiasts of the side of the part of the club really need something interesting for you to pick up their interest at all. So you guess which half of the club turned out.
Thank you.
And just to illustrate how far I could prepare for these things, I prepared a book for them. I did it 7 years ago. A manuscript is the art of trying to print it so that it would be the same as ever. Great workshop for the seven champions to take a stand still. One of the problems of the Morris is that you should be able to be invisible at times, and that means doing nothing but distract whatever's going on. That's really sound too. Now, so much about the Morris is dependent on non-verbal communication, NBC, or conventionally body language, or message. As you know, or perhaps you don't know, that the average person talks to somebody else for 11 minutes each day. One of the problems between married couples is that we don't talk to each other. It's normal. No, don't say that. Most of the things that you communicate are by your appearance and your body language, or even your message you're giving by the day. It's almost impossible to modify what you do. These are deeply ingrained habits of movement. Those who've met the Alexander Technique people, it's all about having enough to educate your body, yourself as it were, to do something properly rather than not so properly. And it takes a long time to get rid of bad habits. And what's more, you can't get rid of them just by thinking about it. You actually need a guide. Standing. It's very easy to stand on your heels. I don't really stand on the heels. If you don't put toes to work in one direction there, you should be able to recognize it. That's the issue most of you do stick tapping in. You stand on your hand and you're balancing by leaning back. That's right. Now, what's wrong with standing on your heels? Is in fact it takes you time to move off into anything else. You can walk, can't you?
Yes, we
are. The first thing you should be is very suspicious when the leader actually says something like that. Walking is about falling over. I'm not exaggerating, but to walk forward, you have a choice. You stick a foot forward and pull yourself. It's different. You try it. And pull yourself forward.
I feel the arms coming on.
The body's not really designed for locomotion like that, right? It's much more sensible to lean forward. And then walk. So I'm going to lean forward, small thing on the grain is the grain curves away fast enough that the imagine always falling. Now, I don't expect the forest to go that fast at all. not even this side. But it is essentially being made of balance, because it's a dynamic situation, movement, rather than a static one. So, get your way. Like, say the proper way is about an inch and a half forward of your heels, really a bit under your insteps, where you should feel the weight come down. When you stand, you should feel the weight spread across the foot. Right? You shouldn't have tension anywhere up your legs anymore, because your body is so designed that you stand vertically out of gravity, leg falling over. That having to be tense anyway. And that tenses, we don't need it in the shoulder or the neck otherwise. The next thing about that is that if you're a more normal shape, not like me, you should be able to get your weight all in a straight line. That doesn't stick out, these don't stick out, and this doesn't stick out. Right? If you with your head, the biggest part of most people is that you look, stick your head forward. Tuck it back. Feel that your neck's being pushed up. You pull your head back and push it up. Now, why do that? Because it's a natural and relaxed, that's what you're designed to do. The joint at the end of your spine is up there, not dead in your shoulders. If you nod your head like that, you're making all lot of muscle work. Maybe you're like, that's what you're trying to do. But in general, you should really rotate off the proper joint at the top there. What's worth knowing about pushing your head back like that, about pushing your head up, being tall, in other words, is that when you're driving any distance, you start to feel the strain, that's the way to relieve the strain. The Alexander technique of driving with the car, push your head. Not raise your shoulders and cut your ears, sort of, just push your head up and stop there. Already, you see, if you've got your weight from there, you should begin to feel your weight a bit more towards the ball of your feet. Shoulders are not tensed up, your head's pushed up a little at all, and you begin to start thinking, I'm a smile, this is not pretty good. Right? Now already you see we've got a posture where the message, the body language, is eager and ready, and you feel good yourself when you're communicating that with your body language, you feel good. It's important on the moral side that from the moment you're visible, as you start walking out of the night, to be aware that you're giving a message. Well, let's try jumping. Come on, everybody. Now, the first thing about jumping is let's try jumping using your toes and ankles only, but do not bend your knees. Thank you. touching the grain, there's no way you can alter what you do. Right? You're committed to whatever effort you put into it is the grain, right? So an important bit when pushing up is in fact rolling up on your toes. Your feet are not phosphor bronze springs. Toes and contact the ground for as long as possible. Roll right up. Keeping your toes pointed down. When you land, you land and come down quietly. It's important for health to be quiet. Now let's have a bit slower jungle music. At least one of my friends here was still in the air. Right? Now think about just what this touching the ground. Shoot us. extremely worth working.
That's my bad son. I am the Lord of the Lancet, we are Campolina. Now, when you start doing that tactics, yeah, Campolina, you should recognize a fair number of Horace Baxter's. Because it dates from that. A lot of the Morrison Museum movement, anyway, has these things go there. And that's all about by having a foot. So, old time dancing, the three turning 90 degrees, I believe it's not because that actually makes life inconvenient, I think it's because your partner had a crinoline or something like that. It's a long dress, you shouldn't trip. I'm sure that's the real reason why. Victor Sylvester, the modern form of dancing in the 1920s, decided in fact the problem for the ball dancing is parallel feet. Now, if you stand with your feet parallel, you should feel, not looking out, you should actually feel that you've turned your toes inwards. You feel a bit pigeon-toed. As I say, the natural position is actually slightly turned in. So, the sort of, there are good reasons why all these things are the way they are. So, in trying to get up, we bend the legs so that the thighs can push. Roll up. They won't pitch you in height. Of course, it's velocity. And velocity is thrust. Right? In other words, it's a force you can push on the plane that gets you up. And the trick to get higher is to push harder. Now, that's self evident when it comes to jumping. That should be self evident. But the arms, when you accelerate the arms, the force you accelerate with reacts to the body, Newton's laws of motion. It's an English and invented everything. Oh, that is actually reacting on the ground. As you accelerate your arm up, I can't feel it. But if you accelerate your arm, you should actually feel the load increasing on the ground. And the reason why you swing your arm up, you're accelerating. This is the key thing. So what you're trying to do is accelerate your arms as you push. So you get that extra bit of push, extra 10% thrust. And you do that a bit more, right? Now try jumping, put your hand up front. So let's try and do the opposite.
We have some inverse jumping.
Backwards.
Damn if I can just think of a logical argument. I'm just going to do it the way it works. way, you come Cambridge in hand, it's also minimises the damage. It's not very much, but it helps in your language. This is more jumping music, normal jumping music. Thank you. showing him to people is different. Many years ago, I did a workshop in London with Bath City, it was actually Trinity Vanity, and the then squire of the room said to me, "You'd never expect to see six Roy Dominic downtown." And I thought, that's the last time anybody will ever say that to me. So I try very hard, as it were, not to set a good example. I like to try and get a good young dancer who's got technique to actually demonstrate what I want. The old business of coaches are good at coaching, but they're not good at actually winning medals. It's true of Morrison and anyone. You'd be lucky if you find a good coach who's also a top class dancer. Right. This one really jumps with tails, right? Would everybody jump? Put your hands on your side and your pockets on it. Jump face up.
Thank you.
Start with your arms out and the leg out as well. You've got a lot of inertia here.
no problems in that direction. Can we have a little bit of
experience in games, music?
Also has a great advantage that no no matter how much you wave your arms and let it rain, you should actually get your neighbour, even with your handkerchief, you should. But it looks quite natural. We'll come back to showing some sort of space to consult or something. Right, have you all agreed to say what you're doing? You've appointed the squire and the treasurer of the SD. Slowly, to actually minimise the effort. That's counterproductive in the air because it comes to a stage where you're going to have to make more effort to stay in the air than the air. The second thing, the secondary one, which I've noticed in your efforts, is that once you start to jump someone, when you're in touch with the ground, you can't actually shorten that time. So the rhythm of basic step or jump changes because the faster it is, the shorter you're actually in contact with the brain, not doing any of that, unless you reduce the height, and it's the effort that you're going to right? And one of the dangers of dancing quickly is that you put in less effort into the whole thing. And there is an optimum type of speed for Morris that we ought to be going into. Now, one of the problems also is that how many people do say that you wear relatively unfamiliar? Now, what I would expect you from you to say is it's hard work. Because, in fact, the way a beginner controls movement is to tension everything. Although you have not only the movement, but the cadence of the movement to it is tense. You tense the ankle body in trying to control the movement. And when you're training a beginner, you've got to recognize that they have a problem that you don't. You know what they're doing, you're doing it for confidence. They don't know what they're doing, they're actually just trying to mimic something. And not the only way you can control yourself is to tense. Let's just try a bit of do that again with a bit of tense stuff.
It's
a normal social thing. especially, and we learn to break the protocols of normal behaviour and ordered dance well.
It's a very strong word, actually. It's a very strong
word. Oh, God, it's will not learn a lifetime behaviour and so on. Right? And what I want you to do now is to try to go back to the slow speed so that you can make more effort.
Because we're
going to pass. Now, I can watch your opposite. Work part of your opposite, right? And see how far you can copy moves in time. We're getting the same thing, we're basing up and down, the fact that Morris consists of travelling the lane. I'm trying to indicate that there's a classic Morris step, double step, which is basically what the fair is. I'm not able to do it, but I've got two of them. You're up in the air. You have to feel as in the air as this, right? And you swim the leg about the length of a foot, not a foot, because feet are different lengths, but not too much. But I hate to say stepping on the spot music, because if you stop doing the way you do, about 90% of the Morris dance that you do involve stepping on the spot. You do Morris in travelling, that's a travelling set, not a station. So if you face your opposite, we are going to do the equivalent of half get cross and back a few times. Right?
That's it,
yeah. Arms apart, music will play. Try it again. there this time, but start with the half. Start the back so with a good half push. Drive. Come back. Together, the whole step of sequence. serve on with a one hot sunset and one afternoon. You have to learn the four parts. You can't break it down into those bits. Right? Or you shouldn't break it down, but that's not the way you dance. You actually dance these scenes. Right? Let's, Peter sets up, let's do some haze.
Thank you.
Very long. Look at your at the head level. Look at the other dancers at the head level. Be conscious of it. Now, in terms of expression, a vague grin. Back. That's what it is. Who was you? It's actually a defensive action which they recognise. The audience will recognise as well. But they all do it. What is a genuine smile? Crinkles up the eyes as well, right?
Have a laugh, that's right, yes.
But you can't laugh all the time because then you wonder what joke they're missing. You know, it's like when your foreman says, smile, damn you! You know, when you're dancing, you think, oh God, I'm lasting up for that. Because the thing to do is to think of the smile as a gesture of triumph. I have done a hatchet. You know, it's something to go with the jump and things like that. You know, it helps you express vision. If you can gear yourself around to showing, as it were, an emotional content to things you do, you'll enjoy what you do more, and so will the people dancing with you. They know how miserable so-and-so you are being. You know, if you're enjoying it with them, so that's terribly important. I think, first of all, is how you're reacting to it. Now, if you're an actor, trained actor, the first thing they do is they behave well in that sense. You know, they put on the right sort of expression, the right sort of posture, and so on. Whatever they feel they inside, you know, like the crane that's going through tears and all, you know, the classic character, so they would do. Now, actors, the point I'm on is, they are trained to duplicate movement. Some of the great workshops I've had have been with professional actors or professional dancers who do exactly what you say. You know? And that came as a great shock to me. Because I'm so used to the workshop, you exaggerate yourself and you expect something less than what you thought to actually be offered back. Whereas actors will actually offer exactly what you did. You do a little duplicated for you. If you've ever seen the youngsters in Royal Ballet School do Morris, they were taken up to the Woodley side of Bampton when we met, and they came away about an hour or so dancing just like Woodley side. They had no problem, they copied exactly what people do. Now the reason for that is that your vision of what you do is different from what your vision of what other people do. Because if you're seen from here, as it were, and your feet are a long way away from you, as it were, and your hands are closer to them, your mental image of your body movement is different from what it is watching somebody else. So when somebody does something, always something useful for you to do, like a couple of spring poses in the galley, some side steps. Do some side steps in the will you sit and watch? You're going to do what he's going to do. I don't know what he's going to do. Makes you look wider, not pressure, gives the maximum impression, right? And if you're particularly trying to impress somebody, whatever the situation is, you know, it's good to stand with one foot pointing towards the one you're trying to impress. It might be your squire, of course. But actually, that's right, you know, this sort of good. In fact, it's a good message. Good body language, good posture. There are many books about body language that you can indulge in. They're almost never about how you get on with your partner or what to do in courting situations, things like this. But the only one that's in worry about people. So that's sort of a posture. So how you line up, how you walk on, each side will have its own solution to that. But you've got to be aware of the first and last impressions are very important. Now, first impression lasts for 4 minutes. It's one of these psychological facts that the first 4 minutes of contact with somebody, roughly 4 minutes, dominates the impression that you give. Now, this means that when you come home at night, what you do in the first 4 minutes in front of the family really sets the pattern for the rest of the meal, or the evening, and so on, you know. It's that 4 minutes. What the routine does in its first 4 minutes, it's ascending and its first dance, is what you tell the rest of you. You'll be forgiven the rubbish for the rest of the show until you get ready for your final part of the shot. That's the 4 minutes. Less than 4 minutes doesn't seem to establish the fact that it's not your average only 4 minutes that matters, which is why I think you've got to worry about how you stand there. So here we are, they're still. They're all eager, ready. That's fine. Well, we have to increase our exports in this country to survive. I suggest we get rid of this one. I said that. The trouble with information is there. The next thing is age. As one gets older, one's movements get poorer. As joints get stiff, or you just get more self-protective, you actually get lazier in effect. You do smaller movements with less effort, and so on, and the longer. Actors are trained to behave like young people or old people. It's part of their training to look at how they're older people never even realise there's a difference. Until recently I saw the Francis Sherwell's Bounty Side dance, and my first reaction was, God, they looked like the old men did back in the late 50s. And then I realised what it was, that all the young men who I'd met in the early 60s, were now as old as the men were in the 50s. And in fact, the difference wasn't they were trained differently, which I'd spent a lifetime believing, it's just they've beholden them. And they have old movements. Now, that's an important factor because you tend to choose as foreman of a side somebody who's knowledgeable, has ideas, and others put it around a bit, and they're old. And if you use them as a role model, you can well end up with a very old-looking side. When I was with Andrew, the average age was 51. It was an old side, whether we liked it or not. When they got a new generation of dancers in, people in their 20s, all of a sudden the whole tradition came alive. It's not impossible for older people to dance like younger people. You have to be careful about the warming up, you know, so you don't overstrain yourself. And that's why you're inhibited in moving anymore, is that the fear effect of hurting yourself in one way or another. So you need the warming up, you need a certain amount of fitness. You know, the problem is that one practice night a week is not enough activity to be fit. You actually need two or three sessions a week to work out, to actually have enough fitness not to suffer from doing anything energetic. And by that I mean swimming, cycling, working out in the gym, which is good, brisk for 20 minutes and so on, is what's required to achieve that degree of fitness. it's important when you're old. By old, I mean what used to be old before. Old nowadays is something more than mine. You're old, you're certainly old. In terms of Dartsman Morris, I've been told since 1971, 20 years. You wouldn't have been 40, you have to really know what you're saying, what you're trying to achieve. Alternatively, at this point, if you're a foreman, a 40-year-old foreman who's actually beginning to feel the effects there in the group, the role model you get something to follow is not yourself. There's absolutely nothing wrong, as in every other sport, of having a coach who's not at the forefront of the activity. Somebody who actually understands what it's all about, can teach what it's all about, but actually uses the good dancers as an example on what to do. This is important, therefore, in practice. When you dance in a set, you try and dance opposite somebody who's younger. It's physically impossible for a younger person. but be conscious. Of a quality. You only have to do it for 2.5 minutes at a time, it's the average length of the clock's 1.5 minutes. It really isn't that difficult, you just have to be aware that these are approximately normal. Right. Now, the problem about body language, non-verbal communication, is that you can't form the audience, really. No matter what you do superficially, smile, it can be like a sitting thing. You've done your bit, I'm very thankful for it. It's very easy for other parts of your body language to be contradicting the message you're deliberately trying to give. So again, you actually have to develop yourself so you actually have faith in what you're doing, believe in yourself, in other words. You can't just stand and say, I'm scared to death, but I'm going to look as if I'm not. You have to accept the confidence that you need with each other, you've got to be building up before. That's what friendly you are, that's the way you do it. But part of The virus at least has got a 300-year tradition behind it, and certainly, as far as this century is concerned, a long history of people being aware of the virus. So you, whatever you do, you owe something to the immediate past. You owe something to other virus teams around. If your side dances badly, or our side dances badly, we just query for all the other Morris sides around the area. That could be deliberate policy, of course, depending on who you are. So you that. And of course, the real question is, however bad you are, creates a bad impression for the future. So that the next generation, your own child, your other child, it has to be an environment you generate, if I'm not done. So that cycles me back to what do you exist for, what are you trying to do, as it were, on what impressions do you have. Now, my wife also, I keep talking about standards as if we're an art form. Well, we are for folk art, but folk arts are different from the normal fine arts or the plastic arts. Because the type of person doesn't have a reason to do it. We're not pursuing excellence, we're actually pursuing a social function, as it were, on ourselves and other people. So we don't necessarily find the same rules, but we do actually require some to extend. Now, I want to illustrate something, and I was hoping I had six in my lot. Do I? How many have you got? I'd like to just read the time. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It's very simple. We'll do this, then you'll do it. The only instruction you get is what you can see. Thank you. the side steps of their start and bringing their left foot in front, as it were, and going across the knee with that foot. The others continuing to move to their left, as it were. I mean, this person moving through a left by the slipping screen, turning that way and moving through a left, right? And then this lot move on the side step right bit, and moving to their right, turning that way and moving to their right.
Thank you.
tea was absolutely wrong. And we learned that, but they didn't realise getting dance from other people is not actually good at all. One took into good dance ideas, as far as I'm concerned, after 40 years of this sort of activity, perhaps spending the odd dance which should really worth doing. Could we do Spanish lady? Right. Do the same exercise.
She is a small girl and present with her parents with
now the boots and they have a straight procession all the way up to Windsor. And on one night they stopped in Dunkelsfield House. Dunkelsfield House is what, 3 miles away from here? Well, you can go look at the house, but it's not the original, that one will do it again. It's a more modern house on the side. But what was quite interesting is both the princes, both Prince Henry, Prince Arthur, and Catherine, were noted dancers. So the first thing they thought when they got the government, they'd have a ball to dance together. And then they discovered the Spanish dancers and the English dancers were really incredible. So they had to actually dance in turns. Oh, I'm not excited. She had brought a small packet to little Marisco. So he dum 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 Henry VII rode down from Windsor to meet the bride, and he wondered what he was getting for his money. Is it, with the two princes, and part of the party also met them at the Hamlet Tree of Heckfield, which again was a few miles away. And they said, "It's bad luck to see the bride before I'm married." It's a strange thought now, but you know, bad luck. As he says, King James, what could possibly go wrong? I mean, all we have is the Reformation, the Anglican Church, and all the martyrs, and the long-term battle between us and the Spanish, and us and the French, and so on and so on. The turning point in history. It all could have sunk into the nation's superstition. It all happened here! And that's the great thing. Oh, another thing that happened here, obviously, is that Walpole, when he was Prime Minister, appointed his son, to be the ranger of the Windsor Forest, which in those days ran from Windsor all the way down to here, the port, the Gloucester. And of course, a lot of money came from that post, which Walpole protested and put his son out of the money. So, and the locals didn't like it, so they formed a gang, that gang went back to the place of the walnuts. They went out, not poaching, just destroying it. And shot all the deer and farm and park and so on. Such, and they got known as the Waltham Blacks because of the forest and the two Waltham Blacks. So in 1731, the Black Act passed, making it a fence, set of spears, to appear at night in a blackened place, or some of them described on the place, because you've assumed the coaching. You don't get no other evidence other than it describes. And therefore, for many years, this was used, this act was used to cover for increased the number of hanging offences from something like 12 to 280, for impersonating a Chelsea pensioner, for graffiti on bridges, and all sorts of things which were worth hanging on the rule. And all that started to say, the gang started in Cambridge. So this is a blacking the faces on, is certainly not something you could get away with for quite a long time. Parliament backed away laws in 1840, so you say it's the Victorian time became more respectable to back up the face again. But of course by that time we didn't see there's reason. And I mention all that because when you're more aside, it's useful to have these meaningless stories. The fill in the tale of praying. Why you do things? It doesn't matter why you do it, really. You know, it actually fills in the time like it's done all the time. Right. Hey, you forgotten about it.
Thank you. Use the other one.
Oh, Carol!
You were talking about the way you spoke.